Good morning, all of you. This is for class 11, subject biology, chapter 8, cell, the unit of life, lecture number 5. In today's lecture, we will discuss about blastids, ribosome, and cytoskeleton. So let's start with blastids. These are found in all plant cells and in euglenoids. For example, in Euglena. These are large in size, easily observable under microscope. They contain some pigments. Different color pigments are present in different blastids. Based on the type of these pigments, blastids are of three types. And these three types of blastids are chloroplast, chromoplast, and leucoplast. You can see these diagrams of chromoplast, chloroplast, and leucoplast. Now, about the chloroplast. So, chloroplast contain chlorophyll and carotenoid pigments. So, based on the name of chlorophyll, it is chloroplast. Along with chlorophyll, it also has some carotenoids. They trap light energy for photosynthesis, right? Because a function of chlorophyll, which is present in chloroplast, is to perform photosynthesis by trapping light energy. Next type of plastid is chromoplast, and these chromoplasts contain fat soluble carotenoid pigments like carotene, xanthophylls, etc. This gives a yellow, orange, or red color. So carotene and xanthophylls, these pigments give a yellow, orange, or red color. Next type of plastid is leucoplast. And these leucoplasts are colorless plastids. Leuco word is representing white color. Okay, so these are colorless plastids of varied shape and sizes with stored nutrients. So nutrients are stored inside these leucoplast. They include, means these leucoplasts are of different types based on the storage form of the food. The food which is stored inside these leucoplasts, these are of different types. So first, these leucoplasts can be amyloplast if these are storing starch, for example, in potato. Next, these can be elaioplast when the leucoplasts store oils and fats. These are called elaioplast. Next is alluroplast. If the leucoplast stores proteins, then these are called alluroplast. So elaioplast example can be seen in many oil providing seeds, and alluroplast example like in maize. So these amyloplast, elaioplast, and alluroplast, or can be called proteinoplast because they store protein. Now we will discuss in detail about chloroplast, that is first type of plastid you can say. Chloroplasts are double membrane bound organelles mainly found in mesophyll cells of leaves. So you have studied about the leaf anatomy and you know where the mesophyll cells of leaves are present, right? So inside those mesophyll cells of the leaves, these chloroplasts are present for performing photosynthesis, for helping in photosynthesis you can say, because chlorophyll is present inside these, and these are double membrane bound organelle. These are lens shaped, oval, spherical, discoid, or ribbon like organelle. So you can say that shape is variable. Their length is 5 to 10 micrometer and width is 2 to 4 micrometer. Their number varies from 1, for example in Chlamydomonas, that is a green algae, right? Chlamydomonas is a green algae. In that, only one chloroplast is found. Or its number can be 20 to 40 per cell in the mesophyll cell of the leaves of some plants. This is the structure of chloroplast. Here you can see this is double membrane bounded. So outer membrane you can see here, and inner membrane. So there are two membranes in chloroplast. In between these two membranes, there is intermembrane space. Now, inside the inner membrane, the area which is present inside the inner membrane has a fluid that is called stroma, right? So, stroma is present here inside the inner membrane. And in that stroma, many thylakoids, which are also, you can say, sac-like structure and membrane-bounded. Okay, so these thylakoids are present here inside the stroma. You can see here these thylakoids, and these thylakoids are stacked over each other, right? And this complete structure, when thylakoids are stacked over each other, this complete structure is called a granum. As you can see here, this is one granum. Now, different granum present in the stroma are connected with each other with lamella. That is also called stromal lamellae, because these lamella are present in the stroma. That's why these are also called stromal lamellae. These stromal lamellae are structure which connect the two granum with each other. Right, so this is about the structure of chloroplast. So now we know that inner membrane of chloroplast is less permeable. The space limited by the inner membrane of the chloroplast is called the stroma. It contains a number of organized, flattened, membranous sacs called thylakoids. These are membrane-bounded structures. Thylakoids are membrane of thylakoids enclose a space that is called lumen. Right. So the space which is present inside these thylakoids is called lumen. Chlorophyll pigments are present in the thylakoids. Thylakoids are arranged in stacks called grana or the intergranal thylakoids. So these grana can also be called intergranal thylakoids. There are flat membranous tubules called stroma lamellae. Okay, these are membranous tubules which connect thylakoids of different grana with each other. The stroma contains small double-stranded circular DNA molecules. So like mitochondria, chloroplast also has its own DNA. Okay, so inside the stroma, a double-stranded circular DNA is also present. And if DNA is present, then like mitochondria, ribosomes and some other enzymes are also present here for the synthesis of its own carbohydrates and proteins. So this feature is similar to that of mitochondria, because in mitochondria also all these things like DNA, ribosomes and enzymes are found for the synthesis of carbohydrates and proteins. Now the ribosomes of chloroplast are smaller than the cytoplasmic ribosome, as we know in eukaryotic cells, because plant cells are eukaryotic cells. So in eukaryotic cells, ATS type of ribosome is found in cytoplasm. But here inside the chloroplast, ribosome 70S type is present. So it is also like that of mitochondria, because in mitochondria also 70S type of ribosome is present. Again, just see the diagram of chloroplast, that how it looks like. It's a double membrane structure. So outer and inner membrane are visible in this diagram. Granum are visible. Thylakoids you can see here. And this stromal lamellae. So the complete structure of thylakoid look like this. Next topic, or we can say next cell organelle, is ribosome. Ribosomes are the non-membranous granular structures composed of ribonucleic acid, that is RNA. So these are composed of RNA and proteins. George Pallad was the scientist who first observed ribosome in 1953. So ribosomes were discovered in 1953. Eukaryotic ribosome has two subunits, 60S and 40S, because here we are doing the cell organelles of eukaryotic cell. We have already done about the ribosome of prokaryotes, right, which was 70S type. Here यूकैरियोटिक राइबोसोम इज एटीएस टाइप एंड दी टू सब यूनिट्स ऑफ यूकैरियोटिक राइबोसोम आर 60S एंड 40S. 60S इज लार्ज सब यूनिट एंड 40S इज स्मॉल सब यूनिट एंड टुगेदर दीज टू सब यूनिट्स मेक द कंप्लीट राइबोसोम स्ट्रक्चर विच इज ऑफ 80S. S इज सेडिमेंटेशन कोफिशियंट हेयर. ओके, so you can see here this large and small subunit and how these combine to make a complete ribosome. Next cell organelle is cytoskeleton. Cytoskeleton is a network of filamentous proteinaceous structure which is present in cytoplasm. So here it is a network of filaments. Okay, many filaments are present which form a network, and these filaments are made up of protein, right? Here you can see in the diagram this network like structure. Okay, these filaments are present here, many filaments you can see here, these brown color filaments which are making a network, and these are made up of protein. Now cytoskeleton provides mechanical support because it is skeleton. Cytoskeleton means cell's skeleton, you can see. And what is the basic function of skeleton? In our body also, skeleton provides the mechanical support, right? So here, and also we can move because of our skeleton. So cytoskeleton also responsible for mechanical support, motility, and maintenance of the shape of the cell, right? So these are functions of cytoskeleton. And here you can see, as in our body, different types of bones are present, right? So in cell also these different types of cytoskeleton are present. These different types of filaments, you can say, are present, which are responsible for providing the support, motility, and which maintain the shape of cell. So we will study about this. Cilia and flagella, a type of cytoskeleton, you can say. Okay, so these cilia and flagella are hair-like outgrowth of the cell membrane. You know the function of cilia and flagella. These help in the movement of cell, and also in the cilia help in the passage of the substances which come in contact with these, right? So these are hair-like outgrowth. Cilia are more in number, while flagella are usually less in number, right? And so let's start. Cilia are small structures which work like oars, like they beat in a coordinated manner and work like oars. Means when any substance comes in contact with the cilia, that is transported ahead. These cilia causes the movement of cell or surrounding fluid. And flagella are longer, and these are responsible for cell movement. Flagella of prokaryotes and eukaryotes are structurally different. Let's understand about the structure of cilia and flagella with the help of this diagram. So cilia and flagella are present like this tube, okay, which is covered by plasma membrane. And in the core, or you can say in the center of it, many microtubules are present, right? So cilia and flagella are present like this, and in the center of this structure, microtubules are present. Now let's see this central structure. So this is the central structure which is present here in the cell. So you can see this plasma membrane around it. So plasma, it is covered by plasma membrane. And in the core or in the center, you can see all these structure which are microtubules. Okay, on the peripheral side, peripheral microtubules are present, while in the center, central microtubules are present, right? Now these peripheral microtubules are joined with each other, you can see here, with the interdoublet bridge, that is green colored line you can see here. This is called interdoublet bridge for joining the peripheral microtubules as well as central microtubules. So this interdoublet bridge is present here, and arising from the peripheral microtubules or the doublets, you can say, there are some proteinaceous filament which are called radial spokes. So these radial spokes are also present here, which is made up of protein, arise from the peripheral microtubules. And central microtubules are covered by a central sheath. So this is about the structure of cilia or flagella. You need to make this diagram. Note last one. Cilium and flagellum are covered with plasma membrane, as you have seen in the diagram. Their core is also called exoneme. Okay, so this core or center, you can say, it has many microtubules, and these microtubules run parallel to the long axis. Exoneme has 9 pairs of doublets of radially arranged peripheral microtubules. Okay, the microtubules which were present on the periphery, as you have seen in the diagram, those are 9 in number, and a pair of central microtubule, as you have seen in the center, a pair of microtubule is present, right? That's why it is called 9 plus 2 arrangement or 9 plus 2 array, because 9 are present on the periphery and 2 are present in the center. So this arrangement is called 9 plus 2 array. The central tubules are connected by bridges and are enclosed by a central sheath. So you have seen that central sheath in the diagram. It is connected to one of the tubules of each peripheral doublet by a radial spoke, right? The central sheath, which is covering the central tubules, is connected to peripheral doublet, peripheral microtubules, you can say, by radial spoke. Thus, there are 9 radial spokes. Okay, so we know that number of peripheral doublets is 9. That's why radial spokes will also be 9. The peripheral doublets are also interconnected by linkers. You have seen that green color linkers also in the diagram. Cilium and flagellum emerge from centriole-like structure called basal bodies. So in the first diagram, you have seen that basal body. Okay, in which that plasma membrane and the central part has been shown. So we can say cilium and flagellum emerge from basal bodies. Now, based on today's topics, your homework is to make the diagrams of chloroplast and cilia or flagella, and also differentiate 3 forms of plastids. Now let's discuss the homework solution of previous lecture. This is question number 12 of NCERT, that both lysosomes and vacuoles are endomembrane structures, yet they differ in terms of their functions. Comment on this. So the answer is, first we need to recall about the endomembrane system, that what is endomembrane system, because here we are saying that both are part of endomembrane system, right? So just let's recall about the endomembrane system first. The endomembrane is an intercellular system responsible for the flow of materials from one to another part through vesicles. Some of its components are vacuoles, plasma membrane, endoplasmic reticulum, lysosomes, and Golgi apparatus. Lysosomes are membrane-bound organelles that release lytic enzymes to digest worn-out cells. Hence, they are known as suicidal bags also, right? On the other hand, vacuoles help cell to maintain their shape. Vacuoles also store food, water, and waste products. As you know, different types of vacuoles are found. So these different substances can be stored by different vacuoles. So this is the difference between lysosome and vacuole.